Good morning and a warm welcome to this morning's service. It's lovely to see so many of you here this morning on this Bev's last service with us. Just a reminder that next Sunday the circuit are holding their farewell service for Bev at St John's at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and everyone is welcome to attend this. Tea and coffee as usual after the service before we go for our barbecue. And just a note for those of you who get the word for today, these have arrived. Please take your copy as you leave this morning. So it just leaves me time to say welcome, Bev. For this your last service, we look forward to it.
Thank you, Jill. Just to say again, if you can possibly make it next Sunday to the 4 o'clock service at St John's, we're going to have some fun. So please do try and come to that if you can. Invite anybody you want because there's loads of room there. The second thing is, thank you, Jill, for looking forward to what I've got to say. In all honesty, I'm not sure what I am going to say because I didn't write anything down till yesterday because I was not capable of picking up a pen. Because my back has been in spasm all week. I've been in a lot of pain, and it's just kicking off a little bit now. So if I start talking gobbledygook, just leave me away. Okay, just take me out. Hopefully all will be well. We'll see. Welcome to worship this morning, everybody. That's what we're here for, to worship God. We're going to sing two modern songs. So be ready. That's the first one in particular is a little bit on the tricky side, as some of these modern ones are. We're going to start by singing number 35 in the books, The Trumpet Sound, and then number 41 in the books, Blessed Be Your Name. So we'll stay standing between the two. Thank you, Noah and Elizabeth. Thank you. seated. We share in a prayer of praise at the end of every section. Will you join me as we say together, may you be praised forever and ever. May you be praised forever and ever. We praise you, eternal God, for the world which you have created and for our place within it. May you be praised forever and ever. You have given us life that we may love and serve you. And though we have resisted your purpose and misused your gift, you have not left us in our sin, but have sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Lord and Saviour. May you be praised forever and ever. We thank you that for us, Jesus became human. He died on the cross. He rose from the dead and ascended into heaven. He reigns in glory and praise for us. May you be praised forever and ever. We thank you that you have sent your Holy Spirit to bring us to freedom and to new life in Christ. May you be praised forever and ever. Therefore, with all your church on earth and in heaven, we give you our thanks and praise. May you be praised forever and ever. Let us confess our sins and failure to God. For our foolishness and our thoughtless use of the gifts of your creation. Lord, have mercy on us. For our neglect of you and our failure to care for one another. Christ, have mercy on us. For our selfishness in prayer and our carelessness in worship. Lord, have mercy upon us. Here is good news for all who put their trust in Christ. Jesus says to us, your sins are forgiven. Amen. Thanks be to God. Who's seen the film The Rescuers Down Under? I know it's quite an old Disney film, but anybody see? Oh. The Rescuers. Two mice. Bernard and... well, I can't remember what she's called. Anyway, two mice. And the second film is called The Rescuers Down Under because they are in Australia. And it's actually... I find it a very scary film. Very scary film. But there's some wonderful scenes in it, and this one is my very, very favourite. We're going to see the young boy, flying with Marahute the eagle. In the Bible, it says this. In Exodus, God speaks, I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. And in Deuteronomy, Moses speaks about God's care for his people. God shielded you and cared for you. He guarded you like an eagle that stirs up its nest and hovers over its young, that spreads its wings to catch them and carries them on its pinions. Pinions are the outer part of bird's wing. Don't you think that's fantastic? Love this idea. God is like the eagle in that picture, strong and secure and powerful, who keeps us safe and even plays with us, catching us on his wings and enabling us to fly with him. Do you want to fly with God? I want to fly with God. And I think that video shows you beautifully. And the boy shouts, what? Higher! Don't you want to fly high with God? That is God's offer to us today and every day. Fly with me. Fly with me. And I will take you to the heights. We're going to sing another modern song now, modern hymn, and you'll see immediately when we sing it why I've chosen it. We're going to listen to our Bible reading for today from the second letter to the Corinthians. Maureen's going to share it with us. Thank you, Maureen.
Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all, who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory, are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Therefore, since through God's mercy we have his ministry, we do not lose heart. For God said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts, and give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay, to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes, not on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal.
Thank you, Maureen. I've had all sorts of cards and messages from people over these last few weeks thanking me for my and Mark's ministry here in Llandudno, and that's lovely, of course. Thank you for all of them. One in particular caught my attention. It was an email from local preacher Audrey Sherrington. You know Audrey? In it, she quoted St. Benedict, you know, like you do in emails. Now, actually, she hit the nail right on the head because I'm a great fan of St. Benedict. And you may think you don't know who he is, but you possibly do if you've ever read any of the Cadvile crime novel series. I know some of you had. Margaret is knocking at me there. Yes. By Ellis Peters. Or if you've ever watched the TV series with Derek Jacobi, who plays Cadvile. Benedict is the founder of the Benedictine monks, unsurprisingly. Really, he's the founder of monasticism in general. He lived in the 6th century and wrote the founding document for monasticism, the Rule of St. Benedict, the Rule. And Audrey mentioned one of Benedict's comments from the Rule in her email to me. Imagine that, two 21st century people exchanging emails about somebody who lived 14 centuries ago, and being able to quote him. But, you see, she quoted Benedict to me, and I quoted St. Paul and Isaiah back at her. So I win, don't I? Because I was going even further back. But that's one of the glories of religion, isn't it? We can call on such a depth of wisdom and understanding to help us in our own lives. Anyway, Audrey was saying that she had realised that I had suffered quite a number of knockbacks during my time in Llandudno, but I had never given up. And she quoted Benedict, who advised, "Even when we fail, always we begin again." Actually, Audrey quoted it a little bit differently. She put it like this. Benedict was asked by a young brother what to do when you fall. Benedict answered, "You get back up again and carry on." And in brackets afterwards, Audrey had written, "Repeat." Well, that's right, isn't it? That's exactly right. Now I have to tell you Audrey's phrase, "You get back up again and carry on," reminded me of a song, a hit song, a pop song. Does anybody know it? Anybody know it? Chumbawamba. 1997, and it was used, the reason I remember it particularly is it was used in the World Cup the following year, I think. And it's called I Get Knocked Down, But Up I Get Up Again. Yeah, I Get Knocked Down, But I Get Up Again. Now, we're going to play you a little snippet of it, and I have to tell you it is a snippet of it because I couldn't play you all of it because it's got dodgy words in it. But this bit's safe. Can we hear it, please? If ever I heard it, is an earworm. You know what an earworm is? Yeah, once it's in your head, you're not going to get rid of it. And it's been in my head all week. I get knocked down, but I get up again. You're never going to keep me down. And that should help you remember the theme for today. I get knocked down, but I get up again. Exactly as St. Benedict said. I said to you last week that I am tired and worn out, ground down by COVID and by things that have been happening in our circuit over the last 5 years. I need to stop. And so I am. I'm taking time out from being a circuit minister. But that does not mean that I am down and out, that I am finished, that I have been knocked down and will not get up again. That is not so. I've had a number of people say to me, I hear you're retiring. I'm not retiring. Not retiring. Not retiring from being a minister. I'm not retiring from ministry. And I'm certainly not retiring from being a Christian. None of us are we? Because we might get knocked down sometimes, but we get back up again, don't we? A Christian never retires. Never. None of us are finished until we've really finished, until we're over the finish line, until we've won the race, until, as it says in the second letter to Timothy, we have crossed the line and we've got the crown of righteousness on our heads. We're back home with God. That's when the race finishes, and not until. All I'm going to be doing in this next year or two is take time to regroup and get myself together, ready for the next lap of the race, next phase of my life, whatever God has that he wants me to be doing. And sometimes we all need to do that, all of us, carrying on and carrying on and carrying on in the same way, as if nothing ever changes, is not a good thing to do. Now, I'm very fortunate. I'm able to take this time to do this. But I encourage you, we all need to do this every so often. The philosopher Socrates said something very important. He said, an unexamined life is not worth living. Or in to put a different way, if we don't take time to examine our lives, to reflect on our lives, we're not going to live the best life that we could. We're not going to live the life that God wants us to. We need to reflect on our lives. We need to assess and determine what changes we need to make, what we need to do to bring ourselves closer to God and to become, as the letter to Corinthians says, get into the greater likeness of Christ. Well, I hope that you've had chance to do that in recent times. Quite honestly, we should all have had chance to do that in recent times. COVID's been rubbish, hasn't it? But it did give us that chance, surely, to reflect and to think, what next with my life? How am I going to live going into the future? We all get knocked down by life sometimes. That's just the way it is. Anybody here never been knocked down by life? Of course, that's the way it is. But it's our choice about whether we get up again and get going. Whether we, as I said last week, use times of suffering to learn and to grow. That's the first thing I wanted to mention this morning. And the second thing is related to the first, and it's a theme I keep coming back to again and again over my years in ministry. And it's very, very simple. It's this, and you know this already, we are not perfect. Anyone here perfect? No. We're not perfect. But here's the bit we struggle with. We shouldn't pretend to be. And we do that quite a lot, I think. And if I may say so, ministers are particularly bad at this. But really, as the letter to the Corinthians said, we are just like jars of clay. We're simple, plain, frail, and fragile. We're easily damaged. Easily. I'm easily damaged. And I have been damaged many times over these years that I've been in Llandudno, I have. By circumstances and by people. And I know, I'm sad to say, I know that I have damaged other people. And that's hard to say, but I do know it's true. Because I'm not perfect. Nobody is. And when we get hurt, we lash out and hurt other people too. When in pain, our capacity for kindness goes right down. So I want to say that I am sorry. Sorry for any hurt that I may have caused you during my time as a minister here. It does amaze me how ministers, how people can think that ministers somehow ought not to be like that, somehow ought to be better than the rest of us, and ought to be superior beings in some way. I won't say who, but several times one particular person here in Llandudno has said to me, but you can't feel like that, Bev, because you're a minister. Yes, I can, because I'm just like everybody else. I'm not perfect. You're not perfect. None of us are. Actually, that is a good thing. Because anyone who is superior is no use to the rest of us, are they? Because they're too removed from real life. They don't know about our struggles, and so they can't truly come alongside us and support us. Honestly, though, I doubt there's any minister or leader in the church who's in any way better than their flock. And if they do ever come across that way, I personally would be very suspicious. Because I would think that they were pretending. And you know, pretense is really not a good thing for anyone. Pretense puts a barrier between us and other people. Because it's dishonest, isn't it? And what we need is honesty and shared vulnerability. And see, even our God is prepared to be like that. God is perfect. But in Jesus, he came here to be one of us, to be vulnerable like one of us, get hurt like one of us. So there's no pretending with our God, because truly he knows, and therefore he can come alongside us and support us. Speaking communally, this is also very important, because we need to see when someone else in our community is struggling, and we need to share in it with them and support them and hold them up if we are to grow together in faith. I've got a picture I want to show you. I can't remember whether I've shown you this picture before, have I? Yeah, I love this picture. I just love this picture. Can anyone remember what the name of this art form is? It's Japanese, that's right, Elizabeth. There's a very long name, which I can't pronounce, so I'll tell you the short name, which is kintsugi. Kintsugi. And it is the art of making repair visible. See that? So that is a broken bowl that has been made whole again using gold. So the repair has not been hidden. There is no pretense at all. On the contrary, the wounds are clearly visible. Better than that, they're beautiful, aren't they? Beautiful. Now this, I just said, this is how Jesus is with us. He is a wounded healer. He shows us his wounds in his hands, his feet, and his side. He is wounded. We need to know that. And actually, it's beautiful to us, because it means he can truly come alongside, because he knows how we feel. And it is how we need to be with each other, I think, as well. We need to be honest with each other. We need to trust one another. So when bad times come in our lives, as they inevitably do, we have people who can come alongside us, people we can go to, people we can share our hurt with in a trustworthy way, people that will hold us up until we mend ourselves. Actually, I need to rephrase that a bit. People who will hold the pieces of us together and hold us together like that, so that the gold of the Holy Spirit can actually mend us. So we work with the Spirit, not only for ourselves, but for one another, as we build one another up and hold each other together and help us mend and grow together. What I'm trying to describe to you is what a true, honest, real faith community is like. You. That's what I'm describing. And that's how many of you have been with me over these past years. Not every one of you has known the difficulties that I've been through these past few years. But even if you haven't, you've noticed when I've been struggling and you'd offered me a supportive arm or a little word of encouragement. And those of you who have known something of my struggles, then you have provided me more specific support. You have, used the kintsugi thing again, held me together while God has glued me back in place and mended me. Thank you. I want to say a special thank you to the leadership team, because they have been so supportive to me over these last years, and I am very thankful. Very thankful. I hope I've been supportive back to you as well. I've tried to be, because that's how it's supposed to work, isn't it? Mutual. We support one another. We go forward together in good times and in tough times. I want to go back to St. Benedict for my final comment for today. In his rule, Benedict refers a number of times to a particular activity. Does anyone know what that is? Well, I don't expect you to have read the rule in Old English, to be fair. Yeah, or Latin, which was probably written in originally. Anyway, the activity is running. Running. For example, he says, run in the way of God's commandments and Run while you have the light of life. So he is advising us not only to get up again every time we fall, but to get up and get going. Run! Run straight towards the goal. I've already said, none of us has made it to the finish line yet. None except those who have come before us in the faith. And I can tell you that that is quite a number of people from this particular faith community in the last 10 years. I know because I've done their funerals. That number of people, isn't it, of our dear friends. But they've got across the finishing line and they're wearing their crowns. Good on them. And I'll tell you what else they're doing now. They're waving flags like mad and they're cheering us on because they want us to get over that finishing line too. The race of faith is a long one, and sometimes, particularly in these complex times for Christianity and the church, it's hard, isn't it? Don't you give up. Stand firm. Keep going. And when you stumble and fall, get back up again. Someone else from the church will help you up. Someone else from the church will hold you together while the Spirit does his healing work on you. And when you get back up again, run. Don't run alone. Run together. That's what church is about, isn't it? Running the race of faith together. In his letter to the Philippians, Paul says this, I have not already obtained the prize. I've not already been made perfect. But I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. I believe God made me for a purpose. He also made me fast. And when I run, I feel God's pleasure. You know what that's a quote from? That's well done. That's Eric Little speaking in the film Chariots of Fire. I believe God made me for a purpose. He also made me fast. And when I run, I feel God's pleasure. That's great, isn't it? Don't you want to feel God's pleasure? Then run. Run straight to him. Strengthen your feeble arms and your weak knees. Fix your eyes on Jesus and run. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not grow tired or weary. And his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary. He increases the power of the weak. Even young people grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run, not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are like the eagle, so strong, so powerful. Help us remember that when we feel weary. When we are struggling. when we have fallen and can't seem to get back up again. Lift us up on your wings. Help us to run and help us to fly with you. Heavenly Father, we pray for all those we know who are weary or struggling or grieving or are in pain. Pray for those whose circumstances are harming them or holding them back. Pray for those we know by name. Pray for those we do not know in the trouble spots of the world. Heavenly Father, help us to be agents of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. Help us to work alongside your Holy Spirit to bring healing to those we love, to pray for those we do not know. Help us to grow together. Help us to stand firm. Help us always to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. And help us to run with him home to you. Amen. As we come to our time of communion, we're going to sing another hymn now. You may well not know the words. The words are excellent, though. So we're going to sing them, and you should know the tune. Thank you, Elizabeth and Noah. Thank you. Please be seated, everyone. Come to our time of communion, and the bread is gluten-free, that's right, isn't it? Yes, and the wine is non-alcoholic, so it should be okay for everybody. But also, you are welcome to receive. Everybody is welcome to receive. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy, gracious and holy Father, always and everywhere to give you thanks. In the beginning, your Spirit swept across the face of the waters, bringing order and beauty out of chaos. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. Though we turned away from you, your love remained steadfast, and you sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, to be the Saviour of the world. At his baptism in the Jordan, he was anointed by your Spirit and revealed as your beloved Son. In the power of the Spirit, he was sent to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. Sharing our human nature, he died on the cross. Raised again in glory, he lives forever to pray for us. By the gift of the Spirit, whom you have sent in his name, you bring to completion the work of your Son, leading us into all truth, making us a people for your praise, and giving us power to proclaim the gospel in all the world. And so, with all the faithful of every time and place, we join with choirs of angels in the eternal hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. On the night before he died, the Lord Jesus took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of all his mighty acts, we offer you these gifts, and with them ourselves, as a holy living sacrifice. You send forth your Spirit, you bind us in love, you renew the face of the earth. Pour out your Holy Spirit, that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of Christ. Unite us with him and with one another in mission to all the world, and bring us with the whole creation to your heavenly kingdom. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all blessing and honor and glory and power yours forever and ever. Amen. We say together the prayer that Jesus gave us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one breath. Those who are helping come up here to receive. Let us pray. God of power, may the boldness of your Spirit transform us. May the gentleness of your Spirit lead us. And may the gifts of your Spirit equip us to serve and worship you now and always. Amen. Just before we sing our final hymn, does anyone know what this is? It's Pebbles. We restarted our pebble pool here at the back last week, wasn't it? Last week. And there's three prayers, three pebbles, okay? Plenty of room for more pebbles. So we ask God to bless those particular three prayers that have been made via the pebble pool. And I invite you to use the pebble pool going on into the future. I noticed, by the way, quite an interesting thing. This is broken. It's absolutely split in two. And it's been stuck back together again. So there we go. How perfect is that? Oh, thank you for owning up, Pauline. Pauline broke it. John Pass put it together again. It's not been put together with gold again, with gold, but it's been put together with love, I'm sure. Thank you, John. Isn't that interesting? Exactly on the theme. So we sing our final hymn again on the theme. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. Truth, lead us into all truth. Give us grace to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord and to proclaim the word and works of God. And the blessing of God, Spirit, Son, and Father, remain with us always. Amen. We go into the world in the power of the Spirit to fulfill our high calling as servants of Christ. Thanks be to God. Amen. Now, I would stalk straight out like I normally do, but she's hovering and making me nervous.
You can stand on that side.
Just be seated for a few minutes. I'm not going to say a lot, but I just do want to say one or two. 10 years.
I feel old.
10 years. That's a long time to be at one church in the ministry. It's also a life sentence if you're in prison. But you have touched on a lot of things today. And I want to say thank you. Well, we want to say thank you for your ministry here, for your leadership, your dedication, and your commitment at St. David's. So we would like to give a presentation to you. Little gift. When I say little, it is little. As some of, or as most of you know, when Bev and Mark move on, they're going to have, well, they have had a brand new house. And you know these builders, when they do these things, they leave them unfinished. So we have brought you a little gift.
I haven't got my glasses on.
Oh, you should be able to read that. It's big letters.
No, no, I can't. Grass seeds! Ah, excellent. Yes, very, very good. Very, very good.
And because you're moving from Wales, I thought you might be able to do this when you do your...
Leeks. Very, very good.
So I'm just going to hand up to Paul. Then.
Thank you. Excellent.
Paul, as a thank you for all you've done for us.
Thank you. Thank you.
That might come in handy later on.
Thank you. Whatever it is.
You've got the white one first.
I'm supposed to open that.
Can you open that?
I'll open the white one. More grassy. Oh, it nearly is, though. It's garden gift token, everybody. I've been saying to people that this is the first time that I've ever been able to do a garden from scratch. You know, normally I'm picking up somebody else's garden. So that is lovely. That is tremendous. That's a good idea. Thank you so much. My goodness, load gift token. Thank you. I can buy plenty of plants with that. Thank you. Am I to open the other one as well or not?
Well, you can do.
It's up to you. You tell me.
Don't drop it.
Don't drop it.
You'll see.
Right. Oh, I see. It was split. I see. It's a load of cash, everybody. That's really, really. I won't lose it. Oh, don't worry, I won't lose it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Right, let's go and have a brew, shall we? Yeah, let's do that. Excellent.